Hi, Valerie.
Well, hello, Lauren. Great to see you.
You too.
Thanks for giving us some of your time today.
Absolutely.
Well, let's dive right in and tell the listeners a little bit about yourself.
Okay, well, my name is Lauren Brim, and I wrote two books. I wrote The New Rules of Sex, and then I wrote The New American Family. And The New American Family, I think, is what we'll talk about today. It's all about my journey to motherhood in a non-traditional way. I had a baby with a friend, and we currently co-parent. And yeah, I love to tell women about my story because it's something that I think is really needed. Alternative, you know, methods to having a family because of the world we're living in and, you know, how relationships are today and how much we delay having kids and, or feel like we have to delay having kids until we found the right partner. And so, yeah, I'm just excited to share my journey with you today and everything I've learned.
Yeah. So have you always known or had a desire to become a parent, or was that something that maybe transpired later in your life?
I always knew I wanted kids. Yeah. And I just thought, you know, the relationship would just happen. You know, you just date and then you meet someone and then you'll get married and you'll have a baby. And around the age of 30, I had moved to France. I was living in Paris and I had was starting to finish writing my first book, The New Rules of Sex. And I think that was kind of like a freedom that I needed to go, wait, I can, you know, be the sexual being that I want to be. And then I finished that book and then it was sort of like, okay, well, now that's done. And what do I want next? Well, I really want a baby. And if I can be this free sexual being, can I also be this free parent? Can I custom design parenthood and family in the same way that I've now sort of broken out of the shell of Western culture and what it says my sexuality should look like? Can I break out of the box of what being a mother is supposed to look like, being a parent is supposed to look like, you know, making all these sacrifices to stay in this lifelong relationship that statistically, like, isn't that likely? And so, yeah, I realized when I was 30 that I really wanted to be a mother. I had lived in Europe. I'd been educated. I'd made art. I'd done all these things I wanted to do. And everyone said, oh, just enjoy your single life. And I was like, I'm tired of being single. I've like dated so much. I drink wine. I go to parties. Like, I've done everything I wanted to do. And, I mean, I could go back to school, but like my heart wasn't in that. And, you know, I just knew I wanted a baby. And, you know, I think from wanting the baby, I mean, I was pregnant within a year of that. I mean, it really, like, as soon as the idea came to me, it was like,
so how did you manifest that? Like, it sounded like you knew your heart's desires, mm-hmm. and you really soul searched and realized that you were ready for this next chapter in your life, which I can totally identify with because I felt similarly at 30. Mm-hmm. Like, I just felt this yearning and this calling that family is really important to me and that I wanted family to be part of my life. And I was ready to create my own family, but didn't necessarily have the partner in place, which mm-hmm. sounds very similar to your story. So how did you go from 0 to 60?
Yeah. So basically I realized that I was done living in Europe. I'd been there for 2 years. I wanted to be back in the States. I wanted to have a baby and I was going to pursue artificial insemination. And I got on the donor website and I just looked at it and I went, I don't need to pay for sperm. Like I can find someone who wants to be a father. And I just sort of had this flash in my mind of all of these men that I knew in LA who were older and hadn't had kids yet. And I knew wanted that experience. And I thought, I wonder if I could find a man who would want to have a role in the child's life, who would want to be the father, who would want to, you know, see them every day, have some responsibility, have some financial responsibility. And like, would that be possible? Is that crazy? And I just kind of sat with it. And then I remembered that I had this friend that I knew who was, you know, a little bit older than me and had just not found the right relationship either. And I knew he was interested in having a child. So I approached him and we began a conversation that lasted several months and, you know, ended in making a baby and becoming pregnant on the first try. So, definitely felt very meant to be.
When you had those conversations, what can you describe a little bit about the relationship with that gentleman and how that transpired or what the nature of your, because I'm sure as most people are, they're very intrigued with like, oh, is this platonic? Or is this, yes. is he bisexual or gay? Does he, mm-hmm. Is he going to want to pursue you as a physical relationship, or how does that look?
Yeah. Well, I detail it, you know, in my book, The New American Family. So if you want to really have like conversation by conversation, you know, it's in there. 'Cause it is like you're in these untreaded waters going, how do I ask this person if they want to have a baby with me? And it is a really like intimate sort of experience of, and her father is a heterosexual man. And so, you know, I was very clear that I wanted to do it as friends, and that I found that idea really interesting because, well, hey, if relationships are all, you know, if half the marriages end anyway at some point, and I had gone through my parents' divorce when I was 15 and it was extremely painful and traumatic for me, I just kind of thought, well, if our child grows up and only ever knows their parents as respectful and loving towards each other, but growing up in separate households. And I had an example of that actually, because I had lived with a woman when I was attending UCLA, and her ex-husband had divorced when her child was one. So all he knew was spending half the week at mom's, half the week at dad's. And I was there observing going, wow, this is kind of cool for my friend. She gets half the week is like homework and dinners and dance parties in the living room and bedtime and kids waking up and like, you know, pee on the floor and like all the crazy stuff that happens with kids. And then the other half of the week we can put on rated R movies and like go to the bar and have a drink and she could go on a date.
It's like she gets a break.
Yeah. And I was like, maybe I could create that with this guy. So I kind of was talking with him about what he wanted and then what I wanted. And then it was sort of this very subtle, like, should we maybe talk about doing this together? Like, would this be something? And the reality is that he, even though I said, let's be friends, he ended up feeling attracted to me. And I, you know, sort of was very casual about like, once I knew I was ovulating, I was like, well, let's just have sex and make the baby. And that's a question people always ask, like, did you have sex? And honestly, I didn't really understand insemination, like that you can do it at home, which I now know. And I know a woman who did inseminate with an open sperm donor, and he ejaculated in a menstrual cup and she put it inside of her and she's pregnant because her husband had had a vasectomy after his prior marriage. So they just needed sperm and wanted a donor who would be available to their child in their child's life. So I've since learned a lot about that. But I didn't know that option. So I was like, we can just have sex. Like, and then he had a lot of feelings for me. So I do recommend that people inseminate and don't, like, you know, because it is confusing. Having a baby is very intimate. And I think talking to another one of my now friends who also inseminated with a gay man, she says it does get very confusing because you feel these really you're going through this really intimate experience, and it's your body and like your boobs are getting bigger and this person's looking at them.
Your hormones are going crazy.
Yeah, and even just going in for the ultrasound, like they pull your pants all the way down to your pubic hair and they're like, you know, looking for the baby, and like you're just very
exposed and vulnerable.
Yeah. So that was one of the struggles that we had, where I almost wished that he was a gay man at that point, because I felt like it would have been easier to navigate it. Yeah. But at the same time, you know, we have navigated it. We've had lots of conversations. We fight. We've gone to therapy. We have 99.9% of the time, like, we have a really great relationship. Like,
are you both dating? Does that confuse anything?
Do we date?
No,
we both date other people. I've been in several long-term relationships since my daughter was born. One that started like weeks after she was born, which is why I love to tell women, by the way, that do not think your dating life will end because you're pregnant. If you do pursue, you know, artificial insemination.
You probably got more dates when you were pregnant because you probably looked so cute.
I got hit on so much pregnant, which was why I did the research for halfway through The New American Family. You'll see the chapter on dating while pregnant. There are websites for this. Like, and it's not just men that have pregnancy fetish either. It's not like weirdos. Like, they're men that want family. Like, men want kids in the same way that we do. And they're sad that they can't find a woman that they have to feel like, okay, if I have to, and spend my whole life with and be like, 1000% sure that this is the right person. Like, they're scared of divorce and just like the rest of us.
Well, they've been burned and they've seen their friends be burned. And there's a lot of women out there that take advantage of that. And so that's what makes me sad for women that really know they want this as their option and they're looking for that parenting partner and that partner for life. And it's like those two people can't seem to attract, but then you've got, you know, the other people that you think are good match and then they don't try. And so it's like, gosh, why does it seem so hard for people that want it so badly?
I mean, it's a really confusing time that we live in. I mean, we are in the midst of culture changing so rapidly. I mean, in 10 years, it's going to be a different world. And we've got a foot in the future, foot in the past.
Yeah, look at all the IVF babies that have been born. There's this twins. And look at the generation of half siblings that have been created. But you're right. We do have one foot in the past and one foot in the present. And it's like, how do we navigate all of these new fertility choices that are put in front of us, whether it's egg freezing, fertility preservation, or even look how cancer's changed a lot of creating families.
Same-sex couples and marriage and surrogacy is happening so much now. And
The laws can't keep up, it seems like. So So I have to ask, did you seek like legal help when you first started and go that route of like creating kind of a contract or some kind of arrangement on paper, or was this all verbal agreement?
So any contracts that you make are really don't uphold in court. So it's really like that's the other part that I, you know, is important for women to understand, like having a baby is an extremely intimate experience. So know that you want to go through that with that person. It's never strictly platonic. It's going to get really messy. And know that there are laws, and they can be, you know, even if you talk about everything, which my co-parents and I did, and we did actually get a contract from his attorney to kind of look over like all the things
like the
that there are to think about.
Piece of things, or like, was it, or were you in the position where you said, okay, we'll leave that for another show, I guess. But did you have like some kind of agreement like on the financial piece of things?
Okay. We talked about everything. We talked about healthcare. We talked about spirituality. We talked about finances.
How
we talked about
raise schedule. The child.
Yeah, as much, like the value system you have, you know, it helped that we were both from Southern California, that we had very alternative natural views about healthcare. Like there were a lot of things we were aligned on, but the fact is you don't know how you're going to feel truly until you have a baby. Yeah. And the courts these days, it's a good thing that they're very like pro father and not just like giving all the custody to the mother these days. But it also, you know, for me, this baby, my daughter's now almost 2.5, and until they're 3, like they're your baby. Like she's 2.25, and I'm still
nursing her,
and they're always your baby. But there's like to the sort of, for me, the biggest issue that's come up is the threat of my baby being taken away from me, and you know, go like some custody being decided by a judge, and that has honestly been like the one thing that would kind of keep me up at night. Like, oh, like if this person were to get upset at me, you know,
or
my
go
life
off
could
the
go.
Rocker, or date somebody who's very passive aggressive or jealous.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And there's like so many things. And then all of a sudden you go, oh, and that's why I tell people now, you know, co-parenting was the absolute perfect decision for me, for my daughter. I got to have a baby at, I think I was 31, or did I get pregnant at 31? Something like that.
31, 32.
I already forget the details. And you know, and I have the time to, like right now she's with her dad and having her nap and playing, and I can talk to you, and I'm working on a new book, and I get to go out to the theater, and like I get to have this really rich life, because the reality is I don't want to be home with a 2-year-old all day. And the fact that she doesn't have to go to preschool, that we both spend half the day with her, we both see her every day. It saves us so much money. I mean, it's perfect. But knowing what I know, that is the part that scares me. Like it's a lot of loss of power, you know, because this other person does have a right to custody, and they are going to pursue other relationships, and they are going to feed your child foods you might not necessarily like, or live somewhere you might necessarily like. So
create an environment that may not be to your standards or things of that nature. Like that's possible.
Yeah, and as a mother, like when you get pregnant and give birth and all of that, your brain changes and you become very mama bear. And so things that before you're pregnant, you might be like, it'll I'm all cool be fine. About, you're
I like, have no issues.
As a mother, like, no, I don't like that. And then you like, you don't get so, but it's also teaches you a lot about negotiation, a lot about trust. You have, I have to go back to, I picked an amazing man to be the father of my child. You know, he, I custom picked this person, not out of lovey feelings and like, you know, oh, like we're going to,
well, gonna you didn't be confuse romance with parenthood.
Yes. I picked a man who I knew would be extremely present with my daughter because my father was always at work and I wanted someone who would be with her. I wanted someone who wasn't prone to depression because there's a lot of depression in my family. This man has no history of depression. I wanted someone who was financially stable. He owns his property. He rents out, you know, to tenants. Like he wasn't going to be someone who was going to have those concerns. You know, he's not rich, but he has like stability. And many things about him were very stable, his schedule. And I knew that was a good balance for me. So I kind of, when I get like really freaked out, like I just go back to, he's a great father. And that's what I chose. And so, you know, that is definitely something that's important. It's important to know that you can communicate with that person, that they'll go to therapy or mediation with you if you need to, because issues are going to come up. And we live 15 minutes from each other. And wow. Now I'm talking with him saying, you know, I'd like for us to live on the same property at some point. Like
wow.
He's yeah. a carpenter. He could build something. Like our daughter could have like kind of a shared area. And then, you know, now my mother's moving out here. I'm like, you can live on the property. Like, we'll just create our little, like,
your village.
Yeah. But you know, it's like, you've got to be creative. Like, it's about creativity. And when you're thinking outside the box, you know, anything's possible. So you're like, what is possible? And
you, I just find you so inspiring because you really are outside the box, but not only are you outside the box, but you're creating your own landscape of what parenthood looks like for you, your family. And so, you know, I guess the next very obvious question would be to ask, are you done having your family or are you looking to expand that? Is this father figure that's in your daughter's life, can you do number two? Or what does that look like for you? I mean, is there age factors involved that now would change some of that too? Or,
well, I think I'm 34 now. I really would like another baby, and having one with my co-parent is not possible. He doesn't want one. And also I think I probably just wouldn't go that direction based on some things that happened. And also his age, you know, his age has changed, has gone up as well, like mine, but, a little bit more, you know, he's in a different decade, so it's a little bit more significant. So I am moving forward in that direction. I actually found an open sperm donor, through modamily.com, which, you yeah. know, how I got the doctor's thing. And we built a relationship over FaceTime and texting and lots of phone conversations. And I flew out to Texas twice.
Is that where the guy lives?
That's where he lives. Yeah. And so that was really appealing to me because he's what's called an open sperm donor. So as opposed to going to a bank where your child cannot meet their father until
or
they're
has
18.
Hundreds of half siblings that are unknown.
Exactly. This person is known and he wanted to have a role in the child's life. He's done this before. I was able to talk to one of the women he'd already donated to. That gave me a ton of peace of mind. I can't even tell you. We had this great conversation on the phone, talked for 45 minutes about everything, you know, and she's got two babies via open sperm donors because the first guy like moved back to Russia. And then that's when she found this man that I was going to use. So, but it didn't happen right away, which, you know, it was like a kind of a shock, like, wait, what? The last time I got
so
pregnant
easy.
On the first try. Yeah.
First
which
time.
I was sort of grateful too for the experience because it does remind me of what women go through month after month after yeah. month when they're trying to get pregnant. And every year you get older, you know, and some women have no problem. And maybe if I tried with my daughter's father, because we got pregnant so quickly the first time, it could happen again, yeah. but you never know. Everybody
yeah, there's
has
a lot
different
of factors.
There's a
involved.
Lot of factors. Yeah, but
have
I just said, I
have
said, you
ever
know what?
Thought about egg freezing, or was that just something not really in your radar?
I think because I had a sense of no, I'm gonna just have this baby now.
Okay.
So yeah, so I didn't think to do it. But knowing the science I know now, it definitely would have been wise to do that at, you know, 28, if I had really thought about it, because yeah, time just kind of keeps going. But my plan right now is I took a break for the summer because it is really hard to be pregnant.
And exhausting.
Yeah, and I really wanted to just drink wine and go to concerts and like have a fun summer. And I have a wild, you know, 2-year-old now who really demands a lot of my attention. And like you're teaching all the time, like teaching. And
small moments of real
life. And like, slowing down and doing what they want to do. And like, it's not like when they're a baby and you can just throw them in the car seat and like run out the door, put whatever outfit you want on them. Now she's like,
opinionated.
I don't want to wear that. You're like, crap. So yeah, so I was like, you know what, it's probably good. And then I might either move forward with the open donor, or there's someone that I have been dating now for a while. So I'm sort of curious to see like, well, let's see what happens with that in 6 months. Cause he's also at an age where he would want to have a baby. I'm also, you know, there's different possibilities.
Right.
That are,
sounds like there's a lot of moving parts and factors that are involved and could influence your decision in the end, one way or another. Later
yeah, but I know for sure I will have more children. And I even did a training to be a foster parent. They now call it a resource parent.
Yeah.
And so I looked into that, you know, I was like, you know, maybe I don't need to have the baby. Maybe I just, I want children in my life. And it's,
or
it's,
to give your child a sibling in any way, shape or form that new family looks like too.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely.
Like
it's so fun to see my daughter, yeah, we went to a friend's house the other day and she was all over that baby. And we talk all the time about where babies come from and, you know, how you push them out.
So sweet.
It's really, yeah, it's really, she's very interested.
Well, first off, I just want to say thank you for being so open and real about your story and like all of those processes, because they really can be emotionally taxing and kind of personal and hard to share with, you know, every little intricate detail. But I find it so fascinating, just even just your openness, your journey, your progressiveness with seeing how family looks like in your eyes and really pursuing that dream and seeing it through. Like, I admire you a ton.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah. So any final thoughts, advice, or maybe key factors that you would share with the audience?
I guess what I'd share is just, you know, really like take your family planning, you know, take it in your own hands and move it forward. You don't have to be passively waiting for something to happen to you. You can move that ball forward and, you know, start to explore options. You can start to look into things like I did. You don't necessarily move forward with the sperm bank or the donor, but you just start exploring what your options are. And you can date people on sites that are actually ready to have family if that's something that you want to do, and you can negotiate what that looks like. And so I do encourage women to do that, because I have met so many women that and men that regret that they didn't have children younger, because sometimes you think you'll wait for that partner and then you meet the partner and they already have kids and like they're done having kids. And so you really, like, we've got to start to change this narrative around, you know, this is what family looks like and that's the only way you'll find happiness. It's like,
or the only way you'll be lovable is if you only do that with that partner. Because you're right, how often, I mean, love can find you at any time, any age, but how often are you, I mean, everybody comes with their own set of baggage or their own hurdles that they have to adjust to. But if you really love the person and you want them in your life, you're going to accept whatever comes with their package, I think.
And people, yeah, people love, like I said, I got so many dates when I was pregnant. I started a relationship a few weeks after I gave birth. I mean, that was crazy, but we just like fell in love with each other, and I had just had this baby, and suddenly I had this baby and this boyfriend and my mom downstairs for 3 weeks cooking and my co-parent who was in and out. And it was like, oh my God, I have this family that like a year ago I said like all that's what I wanted. And then suddenly I had it. Like, it was the most beautiful thing that ever happened to me.
It's amazing. Well, thanks, yep. Lauren, so much for your time. I really appreciate your open and candidness with sharing your story. And we'll put all of the info for your books in the links below and
thank you.
And share that too.
Okay.
For anyone that wants
thank
to
you so much.
Hear about you more. Okay, great. Thank you for your time.
Thanks. Bye.
Bye for now.